It's a purple power hour.
Yes.
At Plaza Ford. And man, Femi Ayanbedejo, Super Bowl champ, former Raven, joins us now. Why don't I feel so good about this 25-9 victory? Well, I know why I don't feel so good. It's because of JK, and I wish JK stood for just kidding, but JK Dobbins again is hurt, out for the season. And Femi, you've had injuries over your professional career. What's going through his mind right now?
Man, he probably feels like he can't catch a break. I mean, it's just bad luck. This kid was not injury prone prior to the NFL. And I don't consider ACLs and Achilles injuries necessarily injuries of injury proneness, you know, to kind of keep it within context. I just think he had a little bit of bad luck. I'm really concerned about where his, I know he's a resilient young man. Most athletes are resilient. I just hope he doesn't give up. He's too young. And athletes do recover from this. I do know it might damper his expectations on a longer-term lucrative deal. But the most important thing right now is his future as an athlete and his future as a Raven. And I still believe he has an opportunity in front of him to recover from this and hopefully come back next year. I mean, that's really all you can do. You've got to stay positive. So that's my biggest concern for him and his family right now. And it was a kick to the chest when I heard it was an Achilles tear. I thought it was going to be a sprained ankle, and then it ended up being an Achilles. And I just thought, man, this kid cannot catch a break.
So there's no way he could come back. They wrote him out for the season.
Absolutely not. Yeah. Not with the Achilles like that. No, not from what I've heard. I think it was completely torn.
This is totally different, but the same. When I was a junior in high school, I was standing backwards on a slide where you go up the steps and you slide down. And we were on the rec playing around, and it was coming up on football season. And I stepped down. I might have been two or three steps up. And the back of that stair cut right into my Achilles. And it rolled up like a blind.
Oh, yeah, I've heard about that.
Oh, my God. And it was really painful. Oh, and yeah. I couldn't do anything for months. Ooh. It was immobilized. So, I mean, that's just a little high school thing. This guy, all that rehab by yourself, you're busting your ass to get on the field, and then this make you a depressed guy. Question was, is there a time when you say, you know what, maybe it's time to hang it up?
Not even close. Nope. He's got too much in the tank. He's too young, and the surgical skill of the doctors nowadays, if he can get into the right headspace, if he can learn to relish in the positivity around him and the success of his teammates. He's still a Raven. If he can find a way to tap into finding the silver lining in regard to all the positive things that he's done that got him here, it really is. You really got to get into your own head, and you really got to be really honest with yourself, and you've got to be vulnerable, and you've got to talk to people, and you've got to have support mechanisms around you. No doubt
about
it.
That's a skill with any injury, I would imagine, is staying positive, remembering. And now with social media, he can still, like you said, be a Raven, Raven just by doing little updates or whatever and staying in the public's mind.
Yeah, I mean, I put that even third, probably. I would say first, be surround yourself in the real world with your teammates. Be in that locker room as soon as you're ready.
Oh.
Be involved in the game planning if you can. Just pay attention.
Yeah.
It's really hard to stay focused when you know you're not going to play. And I've been there.
Yeah.
You know, there's times where I checked out when I've been hurt and I just didn't want to be around. And I was probably selfish, but I was young, and I know where his head is. So, and no one's going to blame him if he checks out, because he really can't do anything physically. But can he be a cheerleader? Can he be a good teammate and a support mechanism and someone that can help talk some of the younger guys, some of the younger running backs, some of the younger players through what he's been through? Because other guys are going to get hurt. He's not going to be the only one. So, you know, he's really going to have to find solace in his mental, emotional, and spiritual development.
Mm-hmm.
Because physically, he can't really do anything right now. And that's really his only choice. You can be negative about it.
Mm-hmm.
Optimism is free. Optimism is free. I tell people that all the time. It's a disposition that you choose. And a lot of times we feel like we're powerless and maybe the universe is dictating to us, but you don't have to accept that.
That's true. You could say I have a black cloud over my head, or you can just say this is a bump in the road.
Exactly.
So, Femi, we have a lot to talk about. I mean, I'm anxious to hear the take on the game, because to a novice, I have thoughts, but I would love to hear what you guys all think and get our eyes on the future. So, Femi Ayanbedejo, we're just getting started. It's the Purple Power Hour, 98 Rock. It's the Purple Power Hour. Femi, Ayanbedejo, we got you all to ourselves. None of that Dennis Pitta. He'll be joining us next week. So the game, I almost said the show yesterday because that's how I think of my theater background. The show was amazing. The costumes were perfect. The game had a lot of ups and downs. So tell me how you felt watching, where your head was.
Well, let's start with the actual product on the field. I think we all can say that there was some rust for sure. Opening kickoff penalty, opening drive.
Flubs.
I think it was three and out and a sack on third down. Offensive line didn't look cohesive the whole game, in my opinion. Way too many penalties. Way too many penalties, giving the Texans way too many opportunities. The beauty of it is that I think that because we are so spoiled here and our expectations are so high, we have to be honest and realistic and understand that football improvements are dynamic. They happen play to play, game to game, week to week. And I don't mean that to sound cliche. That's a fact. And I believe that this team is still poised to win the NFC North. They're still poised to be a Super Bowl contender. They just have a lot of rust they got to knock off, from Lamar to the offensive line. The defense played really well in general, but I still think way too many penalties. And I would like to have seen maybe a little more promptness on certain key situations. It seemed like maybe Houston went a little fast on defense a couple of times. I'm nitpicking the defense right now. They played
really
well.
Yeah, you are. I hear you.
They had five sacks, but we got to critique it all, right? I'm just giving you my concerns.
That's what I wanted. Yeah. What were your thoughts?
I'll get the positive stuff next, but I feel like there were some times they got caught in between plays. And CJ Stroud is going to be a problem. That Houston defense is going to be a problem. I was very impressed by those kids, very impressed. But my expectations for the Ravens have not changed at all, but they're rusty.
And we knew they were going to be growing pains with Todd Monken's new offense. And I thought it looked good. Zay Flowers got involved, OBJ on some pass interference. He didn't light it up.
He had two catches and an explosive catch, though. He had one big explosive catch. So he'll be more of that. Yep. Rashad looked good too, Kirk. I mean, he had three catches. He looked good. Look quick, right?
Yeah, and no Mark Andrews, which didn't really seem to. I don't know if Todd Monken values the tight end as much as Greg Roman did.
I value a tight end.
There you go. But it'll be good to have him back. But without him out there, hey man, still 25-9. Pittsburgh got blown up. Cincinnati got blown out by the Browns. They're going to be ornery when the Ravens see them on Sunday. But the Ravens at the top, the AFC North 1-0.
Yeah. You make some really good points, Kirk. And I'll say this, you know, I think the way that I look at games, I kind of go good, bad, and ugly. And I always start with the ugly and then the bad and then the good. Mm-hmm. That's my order of operation. But I would say that overall, they handled their business. The way that I feel when I tap into like the athlete in me and the way that I would view post game, I always wanted to win the game first. And then I would critique my play second. And I would say that from a learning perspective, a lot of us, there was something left to be desired offensively, but you didn't have to lose a game to see the mistakes that you made that need to be fixed. You know what I mean? You got to win and you got to learn. Mm. And I think that's the most important thing in football. When you can win and learn simultaneously, usually when you lose, you're just in a learning process. You know what I mean?
Cerebral, Marianne. You see that?
I hear a coach. I mean, Femi, I hear a motivational leader.
There was a fork in the road where I really, 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 really wanted to coach. And I'm ready to play after
hearing you talk. I'm like,
real talk. I just love this game. This game has given me so much. I just love watching these athletes out there play. I know how hard it is. I know how much you have to commit. And you see 3 hours on Sunday, but you don't realize it's about 30 hours that go into a game plan.
And we're going to ask when we get back, how long can you go with the flat brim? Do you got to cut that off at some point, Femi? Or can you rock that flat brim in perpetuity?
In perpetuity, baby. In perpetuity.
In perpetuity, yes.
In perpetuity. There you go, Marianne. Yeah.
Usually it's Femi and Dennis Pitta. Dennis Pitta will join us next week and going forward. More with number 30 as we talk Ravens and more on the Purple Power Hour next on 98 Rock Baltimore. Kirk McEwen, Marianne Sirk, produced by Will Blake, joined by Femi Ayanbedejo, the Purple Power Hour. And yeah, man, when I was a kid, Femi, and we were talking about the brim of the hat before we went to break. But when I would get a baseball hat, I would roll it around in my hand and get a nice.
So it was like a tunnel.
Yep. Yeah, kind of. And then, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, it became that tit hut, that flat brim. And there was a cutoff point where I don't know how old you were, but at some point you had to keep rolling your hat. If I walked out like that, but and you're younger than I am, but you don't care. Is there a cutoff point with the flat brim?
I think it's all about the person. See, I act young, look young, feel young. You feel me? That's me. I can't speak for you, brother, but
same,
I know me.
Same,
you know?
Same.
I can pull it off all day. When I'm 70, I'll be rocking the flat bend still.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
Yes,
that's how I do.
Marianne, do you know what I'm saying? You might.
I don't know. I don't know anything about the brim stuff. Like, I'm not a hat person, so I've worn them flat like that because that's how it came from the store. So I might be out of it. I don't even know.
That means right.
Kirk, you know, but Kirk, you know, I played baseball my whole life too. And I was like you. I used to put a rubber band around the bill of my hat when I played baseball. When I was pitching on the mound, I was, you know, I was trying to look like Darth Vader out there. I had my
what changed.
I do remember that in the 90s, like, or whenever it were the boys would do like, so it was so bizarre. Yeah.
What changed, Femi? You decided you were going to go ahead and go other side.
I think it's what Marianne said. A lot of these hats, you know, and this O's hat, you know, obviously I got it because it's purple. And I could rock it, you know, I could rock it as a Ravens kind of ode to the Ravens subliminal. And then obviously supporting those and what they're doing. But I think it came like this. And I think a lot of my friends at that time, when we got our hats like this, it almost felt like blasphemous to start to doctor it. Almost just leaving it as is and leaving the stickers on the inside and stuff and on top, you know, like that. I've been doing that for a really long time. I know that's a young person's thing, but Kirk, like I said, bro, I feel young, man.
He's young on the inside.
Young.
Femi, I have a question for you. And if you guys want to watch, see what's going on, you could, don't forget to download the Very Local app and you could see the hat that we're talking about. But I have a question because you're, you know, we're talking about hats, fashions have changed. I'm really curious about what was different about football. What has changed in football professionally since you started? Because I know there's new rules, there's new, it's like a whole different game.
That's a good question. Let me start with the top on a macro level. I think that the culture is the best thing that's changed. This ideology around being macho and masculinity, that stuff needed to go away because it was causing people like their lives in some degree. Like this idea on,
I'm not hurt kind of thing.
Well, just like ESPN jacked up, like, you know, glorifying violence. Like those are the plays that were actually causing people to ultimately have head issues down the road. You know what I mean? Legislating that out of the game is the most important thing that's happened. The next thing that's happened is the idea that younger children should be playing flag, in my opinion. They should be playing flag all the way up to high school, in my opinion. They should not be playing tackle football. That's my opinion. I know a lot of parents are going to get mad.
Yeah.
But trust me, my interest is for your children. I went to one of the best universities on the planet, Johns Hopkins, did my MBA there. I've spoken to people from the School of Medicine. I've spoken to people from the School of Public Health. I've done my own research. I have an undergrad degree in psychology. I've studied the brain. I've studied trauma. I've studied TBI. I've studied CTE. There is a component to dementia, Alzheimer's, and future cognitive issues that are genetic. But you accelerate that when you get hit in the head. Yeah. And when you're young and you start getting hit in the head early, you even accelerate it even more. Why put your kids into that situation? They don't know better. You should know better, though. And me, as someone who feels like I'm always trying to look out for the public interest around head trauma and football, I'm going to tell you right now, when parents ask me, they're kind of shocked. I didn't play Pop Warner football. I didn't even play high school football until I was a sophomore.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
But
I played flag. I played flag for many, many years, and you can learn all the skills.
Well, you got your wits about you.
Yeah, you can learn. You can learn football without taking the abuse. And then as you get a little older, it takes a special kid to like getting hit.
Ooh.
And I even had to learn that. You know, my brother came out. My brother came out kicking ass and taking names. He loves getting hit. He loved hitting people.
Great.
I wasn't like that. I had to figure that out later. You know what I mean? So that's how I feel about contact. And those, to me, Marianne, I have a litany of things I could go through, but the biggest, most important thing is what I just said, I think.
I like that. Yeah, the culture. And that's noticeable, you know, even through the years. I think everything has changed in the last few years, and it's great to see that football hasn't escaped that. We have a lot more to come. It's Femi Ayanbedejo, Purple Power Hour on 98 Rock. The Purple Power Hour, Femi Ayanbedejo. Dennis Pitta will be joining all of us next week. I believe he's flying right now or in
he was being honored yesterday. So
Femi, yesterday's game, it's awesome to see the win. It's funny, when I told my mom, she said, how do the Ravens do? And I said, 25-9. She goes, did they play a high school team? She was like, what? But if you watched it, it was a bit of a nail biter in the beginning. And we're happy to get that W on the board. What about coming up next Sunday, Bengals, Ravens? Any challenges you see?
Man, I think it's going to be really difficult to go into Cincinnati and win. You know, I haven't heard the update on Ronnie Stanley yet. I haven't heard the update on Tyler Linderbaum yet. Or Marcus Williams. Mm-hmm. You know, those are three other guys that got dinged in that game. I don't know if they're going to be available, but we're going to need everybody. And obviously, Marlon Humphrey's already out. JK is now down for the season, right? So I'm concerned because we've had problems with Cincinnati, especially in Cincinnati, and they didn't play very well. But the thing is, Cleveland's had their card for a while now. Cleveland has given them a difficult time for a while now.
Isn't that crazy?
It's insane. But they own
the Bengals.
It's just the way that it works, you know. It's the way that the AFC North works, and it's rivalries. And so I think we should expect to see a little more of the old Cincinnati when they play us. And you know, Cincinnati has lost a couple guys on both sides of the ball. You know, P. Ryan's not there. He balled yesterday too.
Yeah.
I think is he on the Cowboys now? I think he's on
it's
the Cowboys.
Bronco.
Is he a Bronco? P. Ryan's on the Broncos. Okay. All the games blended yesterday, and the Cowboys destroyed the Giants yesterday. So I think they're just top of mind for me. But in regard to Cincinnati, maybe they take a step back a little bit. But I still think they're going to be a very, very, very tough challenge. Once again, it's always going to be tough with a division rival. And we know what they've done the last couple of years. You know, everyone's kind of made Cincinnati the heir apparent to Kansas City. But I think the Ravens are going to have something to say about that. I had the Ravens winning the AFC North before yesterday, and obviously there's plenty of games to go. But I expect it to be a very, very difficult game in Cincinnati next week.
And do you enjoy the game when you watch it, Femi? Or is your mind so analytically working, you're always – sort of at school and you can't enjoy the game?
Kurt, that's such a good question. It really is, because I find myself in that mode and I have to check myself sometimes and be like, man, just enjoy this. Like, you don't have to sit here with your notepad and scribbling and critiquing everything.
Yes, you do.
Yeah, I just know how I want a game to feel. And when the game doesn't feel like that, I start getting into analytical critique mode. You know, and I would say that like being critical, you have to – critical thinking involves numerous things. One is obviously what your eyes and your ears tell you and what you see, and also understanding all the variables that are in play and why something might not be going correctly. And maybe I'm able to do that, but I don't know if necessarily if fans are always able to do that. And what I enjoy doing is pulling back that curtain and saying, these are the things that you should be looking at, and this is why the game is going this way. And this underlying thing that no one's talking about is having a massive effect. I think yesterday, the biggest thing was not having a preseason. That was huge. And also Coach Monken being new. I also think that has a huge effect. I think most people can see those things, but there is a gelling and a cohesive period of time that needs to take place in live bullet games, not in a preseason, not in practice, real games where real teams are trying to take your head off. That's where the most learning is going to occur. And I think you should see the Ravens continue to make an upward kind of positive trajectory upward as the season goes on.
Well, a couple things. You can see the whole show tomorrow on our app. We're going to put that up tomorrow morning. Also, the very local app. Yeah, the very local app is out there. The 98 Rock app. You should have all the apps. How many pages of apps do you have, Femi? Five?
Oh, six, my God. I think I have five, because being in tech as it is already, I think I have five screens of apps.
But do you put them in their little categories? So each has...
You know what I do, Marianne? Man, you guys are on it today.
The phone does that.
I organize them in a way that is, most used to least used.
Yeah.
You know, and I also organize them by category. So the ones that are like all my music ones are all together. All my streaming ones are all together. All my banking ones are all together.
Do you do that, Kirk?
If I don't, the phone does. If you keep scrolling, it'll put them all in little groups for you.
Yeah.
They know I'm lazy.
Yeah, they're like, this guy needs help.
and you're old, Kirk, because you already admitted it. You already said you were old. So
because I bend my rim.
He bends his rim. He's a rim bender. Powered by Plaza Ford.
Purple Power Hour, the first one in the books. Thanks a lot to Plaza Ford. Also, check us out on the very local app. We're all over the place. And Femi, we appreciate you. Next week, you'll be joined by another former Raven All-Star, Dennis Pitta. So we'll have double the trouble.
And Femi, I have a question real quick. For the whole season, what's the game you're most looking forward to seeing? Ravens.
San Francisco, Baltimore in San Francisco.
Okay.
I grew up in the Bay Area. I grew up a 49ers fan. Yeah, you know, one of my real good buddies. Actually, if you guys are familiar with Santa Cruz, there's a theme park called the Santa Cruz Beach Boardwalk. Mm-hmm. And I used to work at the boardwalk as a kid in the candy store called Marini's Candy. And the Marini's family, I was like their third son. You know, the Nick Marini, who's the oldest son, we're the same age. We grew up together playing baseball. I basically stayed at his house. You know, when I didn't want to be at home, I'd be at his house, you know, for days in a row. His mom and dad treated me just like they're
totally
I was one of their sons, right? And so the Marinis are big sports fans, Giants, you know, Niners. And I actually might be able to get their season tickets for that game.
Nice.
It'd be amazing, right, to go to on Christmas Day and to be in Santa Cruz for Christmas, bring my kids with me. That would be a cool experience. So that's the game I'm looking forward to the most right now. I'm not saying logistically I'm going to be able to pull all that together, but – you know, hopefully I can.
You start now and you can get it done.
Exactly. If I start now, but you know how kids are. They say they want that now. And then you say, well, this is your present. And then they say, well, no.
And then what else? Yeah.
No, I'm going to spend $7,000 on this. You're not getting a present.
Oh, boy.
UFA.
A minute. I get it.
Undrafted free agent, Femi Ayanbedejo.
Femi. Power. Way to kick it off.
Let's do it again. Hopefully after another victory.
Yes.
Femi, thanks a lot. See you with Dennis next week. It's Kirk and Marianne.